everybody. Good morning. My name is Zach Mandt. Thanks for attending my talk here on matte painting, history, current, potential future stuff. And it's an honor. It's humbling to be presenting here at this event, like shoulder to shoulder with all this incredible talent and all these skilled artists. It's just, yeah, it's quite an honor. this is a quick overview. I'm going to go through a little bit of my background and my career. And then hit on some of the origins and history of digital matte paint or matte painting, glass matte painting, and where that started, where it came from. I'm going to go ahead and then talk about more current matte painting, 3D and digital matte painting techniques, and kind of touch on some of that stuff. And then after that, I'm going to hit a little bit on some kind of simpler, basic concept art stuff that you get asked to do as a matte painter. Or environment artist in the industry. And then after that, we'll kind of go into some of the new and exciting techniques and opportunities that are coming up in the field with the advent of AI, VR, all those aspects of it. So I'm going to show my demo reel here in a second, but at any point in this presentation, if you have any questions or anything, don't hesitate, just shout it out, stop me, and I'm more than happy to talk about that stuff and answer anything. So. Just gonna play my demo real quick for anybody that didn't get to see it on opening day. Actually, before I do that, a little bit about me. Sorry. So as you can see, these are some of the films that I've worked on over the last 10 or 12 years. I've been in the industry approaching 13 years now. Currently working as a digital environment artist, matte painter at Digital Domain in Los Angeles. It's kind of been my home base for quite a few years now. But I've also gone out and done, you know, side work here and there, and freelanced, and had a lot of really cool opportunities there. And this field will definitely provide you with all sorts of crazy opportunities and expose you to things that you might have thought you would never get into. But that's another talk. I'm an avid photographer, designer, maker, off-road rock crawling enthusiast, among, you know, also kind of village idiot in my own eyes, but. Majority of my professional career has been spent as a digital matte painter and kind of generalist, but over the years I've developed some of the crucial skills to supplement my work, mainly creative problem solving. And just the entire world is kind of a Rubik's Cube to me that I still haven't solved yet. But that being said, here's my reel.
Down. on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down.
Started from. Whenever I give presentations like this, I always try to include a history of matte painting to give people an idea of where it came from, because it's kind of a really unique aspect of the filmmaking process. You know, even current day in Hollywood, it's very it's kind of like a secret that Hollywood has. It's getting a lot more traction now, and people are kind of like more aware of it, and it's getting glamorized a little bit here and there, but. For the longest time, people weren't allowed to talk about it at all. It was a very big secret. I'll get into that a little bit. But it's often, you know, it's often misunderstood and overlooked. It's a huge part of every film that we've seen since, you know, the early 1900s. So a lot of us probably haven't seen all those films. But I've been lucky enough to work and train with some of the talented artists that we're going to talk about in here today. So get kicked off here, and it's often referred to as the invisible art, because the whole purpose and goal of matte painting was originally in contrast to creatures, monsters, characters in general, it was meant to just be blended in, and you weren't meant to notice it. It was supposed to be a substitute for actually shooting on location, which is also, you know, that's what the secrecy was all about. So long before they had access to the first digital effects, they had to get creative with matte paintings, because that allowed them to not have to fly a bunch of actors halfway around the world, and then they could also open it up to create places that didn't exist. They could kind of travel back in time and shoot things that, you know, time travel's still impossible. The first known matte painting was painted on glass in 1907, by an artist named Norman Don for the film Missions of California. We're gonna get to that in a second. But the main purpose was saving the studio money. It was really expensive, as I said, to fly an entire crew around the world. And this way they could just shoot it in the studio and then paint the backdrop in and just put it right up. Originally regarded as low position, little to no respect. And that's thankfully changed quite a bit, I think. You know, you have people like Dylan Cole, Robert Stromberg, who have really pushed matte painting to the forefront. I can kind of pinpoint it back to the Lord of the Rings franchise really brought matte painting up into the front seat, sitting up with the drivers. So before that, it was really still just kind of, you know, it was something that happened, but it wasn't up in the forefront like characters and all that kind of stuff, monsters and whatever. In the 30s, well into the 70s, and even to some degree, current matte paintings are not openly acknowledged. It's another thing. I've worked on a few films recently in certain franchises where they just said, no, we're telling everybody that we shot this in camera, and mum's the word. So, all right, you know, not my circus, not my monkeys. The studios, yeah, they just didn't want people to know that they're not filming on location. And then there's also other types of political pushes that they have with, you know, opinions on the internet, and they just gather all this data and kind of operate based on that. But it's just interesting. So this photo here, as you can see, it was a really intimate setting with all these incredible artists. These guys are all titans of this industry, you know, from back early on. And they were all just sitting in a room doing paintings together. You know, nowadays this would be the same kind of room as just six guys on computers. they also didn't get a ton of notes. They're just sitting here painting, doing oil paintings on masonite or glass. And it's incredible to see how much has changed, but how much hasn't changed over the years. So we'll go through how these original matte paintings were done and set up. You have an actual scene with real structure where they would shoot. And there would just be, you know, something, a small building like this off in the distance. And then you would have a plate of glass with the upper part of the structure where you would extend out, and you can see how the camera is set up to shoot looking through the glass, and then beyond the glass is the actual scene that you're shooting, which might be people walking around or moving elements or the actual thing that they were filming. And so the piece of glass would typically be about the size of a shower door, just so that they could get it out onto a location easily enough. And the artist would actually then paint on location. They would paint the glass right there with the camera set up so they could constantly go back and look through it and make sure that everything was lining up. And it was a really, like, I don't know that I would have the skill currently to even pull it off. Computers have allowed us to cheat so many things now that the same skill set is just, it's not irrelevant, the skill of actually being able to paint and understand lighting and composition and perspective is all still very real, but it's just a completely different process now. It's not at all what it once was. We have so many shortcuts and just the technology that's been introduced has changed the face of it completely. But here's some stills from the Missions of California. It's the one that I mentioned a minute ago. From the point of view of the camera, combining the painting with the real background, you could extend your sets. The trick is you need an incredibly skilled, talented artist to make it work. In the top left, you see they're looking through the camera, and then there's the glass panel. And then on the right, you have the actual painting. The top right is the actual painting. And the bottom left is the footage that they shot. And the bottom right is the composited image. And so there's no post effects in here or anything. This is how matte paintings were done for the better part of 50, 60 years. They literally just painted on glass, put it in front of the camera, and then let everything else show through. No optical compositing like we had all the way through the 80s and 70s. No anything else. It was just in-camera effects, which is really cool, because I've actually tried it a couple times, still using digital techniques, setting up a camera, shooting something, doing the digital matte painting, printing it out and cutting it out and then shooting it, and I never got it to look halfway as good as I wanted it. So these people were crazy. They also didn't have the crazy high-res digital cameras we have now, so they're still awesome. This is a multi-plane glass setup. This was kind of a newer thing. Once they started getting the hang of matte paintings and seeing how successful it was in their purposing, they started to expand the technology, and they used it in conjunction with miniatures and stop motion. Like Ray Harryhausen was now on the scene doing his stop motion stuff, and they said, "Hey, we can make something new with this," which is brilliant, and it resulted in entirely new genre of fantasy films being realized, and now you had an entirely different kind of film. Visual effects was kind of starting to be born at this point. There was a lot of little optical compositing tricks and all this, and this was a really elegant solution to realizing fantasy worlds that just didn't exist. So this is a multi-plane matte painting setup where they sandwich the stop motion in between, and this is an illustration of the original King Kong movie. So then after you look through the perspective of the camera, you have this. You have an integrated scene. You're actually able to shoot it in camera, no post-processing required at all, once again. And at the time, this was an unprecedented procedure. This blew people's minds. This is as common a setup as file open now. You know, it's just, this is kind of set the way that we work still, really. It's reversed in its application a lot of times now, whereas we'll do the matte painting as a multi-plane setup and then add in the footage after the fact. So it's funny, because it's kind of flip-flop. We'll get into that a little bit later on here. We'll go through some examples of some of the original glass matte paintings and masonite matte paintings that made this kind of this whole part of the industry really move forward. This one here is from the film called The Paradigm Case, and this is most likely done on a soundstage. This is the composited image, and then this is the mat. You can kind of see there in the central area where, and around the edges, where that's all a painting. And if I go back, you can see, you know, he's standing there in the doorway. There's a candle. There's some other stuff, the chair. I mean, where all of that was a matte painting. And it's kind of, that's, you can see how invisible that is in the film. And so, you know, for the only thing that was real is the character and the actress, or the chair and the actress, I mean, sorry. So that's kind of neat stuff for the time even. Here's a couple of classics. This one's from The Wizard of Oz. It's an Albert Whitlock, I believe. And this one's a little more kind of fantastical, but that's, you know, it's always surprising for me to look back on this stuff and see what was set versus what was painting, because you just, watching it as a kid, I never even stopped to think. I just was kind of like, huh, how'd they do that? And that's how. So much of that movie, Wizard of Oz, has so many matte paintings. It's just like every other shot. It's an extravaganza of it. Going back in as a matte painter, I really, truly do appreciate the amount of work that went in. There's, you know, Dorothy leaves and goes off into Oz. That's what they shot, and that's the painting. And so, yeah, the roof structure on the left there, you can see that's kind of a trick that they did a lot where, you know, it's funny because over the last 10 years, 12 years, they've maybe 15 years, they've kind of touted how they, this digital technique where they just build half the set and then you do a set extension, and that's been going on for a long time. That's nothing new. But it is a really common technique that gets used. It's amazing to me what, you know, and when this came out, it was passable. People were blown away watching that and saying, wow, these locations are insane. And the same thing with this. Mary Poppins landscapes. And this is Academy Award for this work. They got the Academy Award for the artwork on this film. And it's, you know, it's incredible. A lot of people go back and reference this as inspiration, including myself. This is definitely in my library of stuff that I reference when I'm coming up with something for a shot. Sometimes, if it applies. This one here, this is Black Narcissus. You can see on the left, the actress is standing at ground level, and then on the right, the painting is extended downward in its exaggerated view. And this is a really common. And actually, I was mentioning yesterday to a group, this is actually one of the toughest angles. Currently, if you get assigned a shot like this with this kind of angle, it means you're gonna be really, really busy with revisions until it goes away, because this is a really tough angle to get photography of, because it's not always, if it's a building like this, it's fine, but it's always like down the edge of a cliff, and it's tough to get the photography to make it work for that. So that's what's amazing about these guys, these people that were doing this at the time. They were painting it. They didn't have photographs to kitbash in there. They didn't have like a big, you know, 1 terabyte drive full of their vacation photos that they could just drop in and be like, I'm done, I'm going home. These guys were at the studio for hours on end just painting this stuff. And the ability to create something like this from scratch is, you know, in oil paint. These guys were masters. They were, yeah.
Just a question. How often with a shot like that would you look at that and the work that it would take to get photographic material versus just like building that in 3D and scattering a forest? Like what point do you make?
That's a good question. I actually, when I get a shot like that, that's actually the first thing I do. I have a big library of photo scanned models, and I'll actually go into ZBrush, model an asset, line it up in 3D, and I'll start almost all the time at this point, depending on what it is. You know, 90% of the time I would say I start from 3D when I paint, just because of the fact that the nature of it is we don't have lock-off shots very often anymore in these films. It's always, the camera's always moving. And depending on who your supervisor is, sometimes you can get away with less geometry to project on, and sometimes people want like geometry that looks like a point cloud, just a solid point cloud, where they want, you know, because the camera is moving around it, so you have to have that detail, and you'll see the parallax, you know, if say this is your cliff, right, and then your camera is like moving around it like that, you're gonna want to have that detail so you see all the little nooks and crannies moving against each other, and so it's a great idea to start from 3D with this and then paint over the top of it, or paint the image first and then take your 3D and model it to the image. A lot of people prefer to work that way, and I'll do both, and it just kind of depends on the necessity of the task. What the task is really dictates the workflow. There's 200 ways to complete anything, and sometimes you kind of get told how you're supposed to do it, and other times you'll be trusted to manage that on your own. And that's when, you know, that's obviously my favorite thing is when they're like, we trust you, go ahead, handle it. Because sometimes when they're trying to manage how you do it, it can be frustrating because they might look at it and say, this is the best way to do it. And then when you get in there and start doing it, it might not be the best way, but then you're kind of pinned down under that and you have to find creative ways to make it work. So it's kind of, you know, rather than looking at it as a negative thing, like, they're telling me what to do, I look at it as an opportunity to solve new problems, because it's, otherwise it would just go nuts. Hopefully I answered the question. Let's see here. This one is one of my personal favorites. It's an epic Rome shot for Spartacus. It would have cost the studio millions of dollars to build this set. And it's the Acropolis, the rest of the architecture. This is a crazy painting right here. I saw it at the LACMA in person. This is the actual painting. So I'll toggle back and forth here so you can see all the people in there are milling around and moving about and stuff. And this actual painting is probably about the size of this table, maybe a little bit bigger. It's about 6 feet or so, and 2 meters. and it's amazing to get up on it. You can get your eye right up on this thing, like that far away, and the detail is in there. There's little bushes, and the highlights are on the bushes and everything. And what you see in the film, you don't even see half of the detail that's in this painting. It is insane. This person took it, and they were like, this is done, but I'm going to keep going. Like, they put real love, blood, sweat, and tears into this painting, and it's amazing. The studio didn't even spring for the foreground pillar. They were just like, yeah, just paint that. those are some Peter Allen Shaw matte paintings, and that guy is, he was intense, he was crazy. Just the stuff that he did really set the bar for the quality of digital matte paint, or quality, I'm so used to saying digital matte paintings, set the bar for matte paintings. Intense stuff. Here's another similar one. This is the stage, and this is the composite. So you can see there we are with the set extension stuff again. And for the film Hindenburg, the aircraft is painted, and then the hangar is the real thing. And moving, I mean, that's kind of, it's neat, but it's different because it's not painting a landscape in, it's actually adding in a vehicle or a, you know, part of the backdrop. It's telling the story of the Hindenburg. Obviously it burnt down, so it wasn't there for them to film. Now this is getting into the juicy stuff now. Star Wars, huge film for matte painting. This stuff took it into, this was kind of the space opera all of a sudden now is on the scene. You have George Lucas and everybody involved with Star Wars thinks it's gonna be a complete bust. They have no idea what they're sitting on. And they're just, you know, they open the well and they strike it rich with this. And they have all these amazing painters working, creating these insane backdrops. And for me, the thing that blows my mind with these is how many of these stormtroopers are painted, and I'll give you a hint, almost all of them. The only people that aren't painted are the people that are walking in the scene, and it's pretty crazy. These paintings I've seen in person also, they are gigantic. These paintings are huge. They're like the size of those two of those boards back there together. They're pretty amazing. And there's this one, the Millennium Falcon lands in Cloud City. And here's some more. Ralph McQuarrie is one of that was the painter who's responsible for a lot of the Star Wars matte paintings. Another amazing painter. Him and Alan Shaw were, you know, shoulder to shoulder, they were titans of this. He was one of the main, Ralph McQuarrie was one of the main designers of the entire Star Wars world. I'll show a little bit of art from another guy named John Berkey, who a lot of the Star Wars artwork was based on John Berkey's insane space opera themed paintings, and just really, really cool stuff. Super futuristic for, you look back at it, and it's, you know, the 60s and 70s was like this time for pulp sci-fi stuff, and his vision was just over the horizon. He saw what was, you know, stuff that's even futuristic by today's standards, but coming soon. And this one for Planet of the Apes, this is the biggest scene in the film, the great reveal, the piece de resistance, a simple matte painting. Shot right along the beach, and Charlton Heston drops down and screams either maniacs or midiots, depending on how well the audio is. And yeah, that's the Statue of Liberty there. You know, we nuked it all. They did it. We lost it. And it's right there. It was so, you know, it's such a simple thing, but it adds so much to telling the story of the film without anything. You know, it probably took whoever painted this, it probably took them a couple days to paint, you know. But that's an immortalized image now. So, and iconic, and you know, it's film history. This one, love this one. Great Indiana Jones, the storeroom where they stashed the Ark of the Covenant. And this is a great one. That whole, just, you know, where the guys are with the box, that's all that's real. Everything else is a big, huge painting. And I love this one because it really illustrates how much depth and the scale of what you can achieve with this technique. You know, can you imagine building, sure, it's all just a bunch of cardboard boxes if you build it on set or do it as a miniature and it's, you know, fits on this table, force perspective, yada, yada, yada. But this, you know, this way you have a lot of wiggle room to do this stuff. This one, it's pretty hard to film. Get a camera crew into the White House, so they just built a little bit of a set and painted the White House around it. This one is for the shadow. It's by another painter named Robert Stromberg. He's an amazing artist. He's a matte painter who eventually transitioned into directing. I worked for him on Maleficent, was his first break into feature film. And you know, that was an interesting thing to have a matte painter in charge of directing a film. That was the first time that I had encountered it. On Fast 7, the directors, there was kind of a co-director team, and both of those guys came up through digital matte painting as well, and then, you know, also real matte painting. So, well, also non-digital matte painting. It's all real, isn't it? And so Stromberg has, the way that he worked, it was everything that could be a matte painting was a matte painting. It was very matte painting forward, working on Maleficent, and it was a lot of 2.5D projections and all sorts of crazy stuff. But Stromberg has roots in the original, you know, in the original history of matte painting. He painted on glass for years before, and he was also, he had the foresight to adapt to the digital stuff when it came in, and he's amazing. They can hand him anything, and he can have it completed in a day. He's, you know, and it's passable. He's just so skilled, and he's been doing it for so long. He knows exactly what needs to go where. He's like one of the people, you watch him solve a Rubik's Cube, like speed Rubik's Cube stuff. Watching him do a painting is like that, and I just sit there and I'm like, okay, wow, all right, whatever. I've got work to do.
Zach?
Yes?
Having a director that has a background in matte painting, did that change the workflow of how you guys worked as a team?
Not so much as a team, like how we worked, because we're, you know, as a team, as the Digimat team, we're doing Digimats. But it was the scope of the work and the amount of changes that he expected from it, and the turnaround time definitely was different. And a really cool thing about it that I didn't mention, that was different with Stromberg as the director, was we would get, you know, he's not just a painter, and he knows 3D really well. So Stromberg would take these scenes, he would take like the fly-through stuff that's on my reel. I originally got that, all that stuff as models. He had roughed out models and done previs of all this stuff, and he did it in Lightwave. So I had Lightwave files that I had to cross over to Maya and get all that stuff rebuilt. But that was that was really cool to have a savvy director who actually understood the process. A lot of the times you'll work with directors, and almost all the time, you know, the case is always you're working with a director who came up through something else. He went to like film school and he's never touched 3D in his or her life, like, and they kind of don't understand, and so you have some challenges to kind of translate what is our world and our reality and merge that with theirs and kind of let them know, like, okay, this is what's possible, you know, in this amount of time versus, and you have to really work extra. Whereas with Stromberg, he would come in and be like, this is what I want. I know you guys know how to do it. Go for that. So it was a lot more efficient, in my opinion, in a lot of ways, having the savvier director, because he was, like I said, he was giving us assets and saying, this is what I want. I want this. Here's the style frames for it. You need to make it look like this. But he was also really cool about it in trusting us to, like, he was said, you know, you guys do some style frames too and throw them at me and we'll see what you get. If I like it, we'll put it in there. And so we had a lot of really neat opportunities on that film working with Robert Stromberg. But also he would, one really cool thing that he did was he would give paint overs on our stuff to give us notes. And that was like, the entire team grew. Having that resource, and so that was a really, really cool, aspect of that. And it was a beast of a film. Like, we were there a lot of hours finishing that sequence. But at the end of the day, it was worth it. I mean, it was a huge achievement. It was a great film, and it was, you know, it was a Disney classic. Who doesn't love to have that kind of work on the resume or just that experience? It's neat. So yeah. Yeah, having Stromberg there definitely made a difference, and I'm excited to work with any director who's savvy and knows who came up through digital effects or even regular effects, who came up through that as opposed to somebody coming in from the outside, which is still great and it's an awesome opportunity, but it's just a different dynamic, is all it is. So here's some more Star Wars stuff. Probably been staring at it for a minute now. more space bays and that kind of stuff. you have one for Blade Runner. I've worked with this guy, Rocco Geoffrey. He still lives in LA, drives a Corvette, wears a little French hat, and Rocco's a force of nature. That guy's like having a bolt of lightning in the office with you. He's energetic, he's pumped, he's an older guy, and he is passionate about this, like super hyper passionate about matte painting. And it was funny because the first time I worked with Rocco, everybody would talk about how like set in the old ways that he is, and Rocco came in and schooled me, like entirely schooled me. I was like, let's see, you know, I'm curious to know what he knows, like what he's gonna be like, well, this is how we used to do it. And instead of that, Rocco taught me stuff that I was like, you can do that? Like he was doing matte painting stuff in After Effects, 2.5D projection stuff. I was like, wow. He had it was a ship. He painted a ship and he painted it in layers and just took the layers and removed the layers to animate the ship kind of turning. And I was like, what did you do? How did you do that? And Rocco's a genius with matte painting. And he came up, you know, through painting on glass, painting with oils. He's a traditionally, you know, he's rooted in traditional matte painting, and he always goes back to it whenever he can. He was the main digital matte supervisor for La La Land, and he wanted as much of that film to be done with original matte painting as possible because of the era that the film took place in, which is kind of really cool because that's where that film is rooted, and so why not have that element done by somebody who was there doing it for. Rocco was coming in about that time, so it's pretty cool to have the opportunities to work with somebody like Rocco because he's a great, he's one of the legends, and he's alive, and he's a resource there. This one is also one of my favorites, and this one has some kind of neat history that's pertinent to the industry. Throughout the 90s, traditional matte paintings were still in use, more often in conjunction with digital compositing. Die Hard 2, which is what this is from, this is the first film to use digitally composited live action footage with traditional glass matte painting that had been photographed and scanned into a computer. It was for the last scene, which took place on an airport runway. This is Yusei at ILM. Scale, lighting, composition of this shot is all masterful. This shot in the film still, if it weren't for the quality of the elements you know, showing their age. This is indiscernible from a photograph. This is photoreal painting. This guy is amazing. It's great. And to be able to see, this is one that I haven't seen in person, and I would love to see this painting in person, because I just, that's my thing. I love to see these original paintings and stick my nose right up to it and see like how close I can get before it turns into brush strokes. So in the 90s, digital matte paintings started replacing painting on glass. One of the last movies glass matte paintings were used. This is Chris Evans' painting of the Carpathian rescue ship in James Cameron's Titanic. Programs like Photoshop started getting used in its place. Some of the original glass paintings would still paint, scan, and then touch them up in Photoshop. We're starting to move now into a digital realm within it. Matte painting is still being used at this point in history. You know, they're using it all the time, and it's just the technology is starting to shift. 3D started being used for the set extensions that they would do. So programs like Matador, Photoshop were starting to come online and get introduced into the workflow. The way they transitioned was, as I mentioned, they would still paint it and then touch it up in a digital world. And eventually, the paint started getting less and less used. 3D animation softwares were becoming more affordable, and you didn't need like an SGI to do stuff anymore. Maya was on the scene now officially from Terminator 2, I believe was the film that kind of started using Maya in films, because they had the liquid metal effect, and then all of a sudden after that, everybody started using Maya. Funny side note, having to do with this, the Titanic stuff, they re-released a digital release of Titanic, and James Cameron wanted to go back in and touch up all the King of the World shots, where Leonardo and Kate are on the front of the boat, I'm sailing, I'm flying, and I got to go back in and repaint the skies for all those, for that re-release, and James Cameron's main note was that he wanted more salmon cream in the sky. Snicker about that endlessly. Before we get into the 3D matte paintings, I wanted to touch quick on an event that helped usher us from 2D to 3D. This is technically the first digital matte painting, even though it was done with traditional media. In the mid-1980s, advancements in computer graphics programs allowed matte painters to start working in digital. This one was created by Chris Evans in 1985 for young Sherlock Holmes. He painted it. He painted the stained glass window and this night. He painted this night, and then they scanned it in. He painted it with acrylics, and then they scanned it in using Lucasfilm's Pixar system for further digital manipulation. The computer animation, and that's the different thing about this, is that it wasn't just painted and brought into the computer, it was also animated. So this is a big, huge step in this process. This is a quantum leap for the process of digital matte painting. Or just matte painting in general. Computer animation blended perfectly with a digital matte, which could not have been accomplished using a traditional matte painting. Possibly with stop motion, but it wouldn't have looked quite like it did here. You wouldn't have gotten the motion blur unless you did it as a post effect, and it would have looked a little different than it did. So that was a big deal at the time, and still is kind of a big deal, I guess. What is digital matte painting? Now we've got digital matte painting on the scene. We're starting to do this, and we're having 3D environments, and camera projection is now showing up. Matte painting had been mostly stationary. Now we had changed with the new digital tools. We're starting to pick up cameras, move them around. Steven Spielberg is getting into Jurassic Park territory and saying to these guys, hey, I want to be able to take the digital camera and just chuck it across the yard and still be able to add my 3D stuff into it and whatever. And all his tech people are going, oh God, who are we gonna sell that to? And they're inventing match moving and all these other things. And so in 1999, the first 3D camera projection was created for Star Wars: The Phantom Menace. I'm sure you've all seen this and familiar with this shot. worked by placing the 2D photos and painting elements onto 3D geometry, which is what, if you were at my demo yesterday, you saw me do some of that. And this allowed you to get you parallax depth, and you could project photos on a 3D geometry and then move the camera around it and achieve a really, really cool result that you couldn't get at the time, and still kind of have trouble approaching that level of realism with just completely generated 3D renders. One thing that I get asked about a lot is what is matte painting versus enviro or environments? These are two terms that get thrown around, and they're, for the most part, they're kind of interchangeable. Everybody that I know who's a digital matte painter can do digital environments, and then most of the people I know who do digital environments, because of a 3D approach, some of them can also matte paint, but the two skills aren't mutually exclusive. They kind of, there's a lot of crossover and blending in between the two things, but there is a distinction. The distinction for me and the kind of rule that I have mentally for this is matte painting stops after you've done about 4 camera projection patches. At that point, you're doing enviro, or more distinctly, if you're not actually painting anything and you're just creating an environment from, say, like World Machine, and then going in and using Houdini or Maya to populate a bunch of trees in it, that's digital enviro work. And when there's a big camera moving through stuff, often that'll be a mix of matte painting and enviro work. So it's kind of a silly thing, but it is a distinction, especially when you're talking to the more old school matte painting guys. They'll be real firm on, oh, no, it's not the same. And it isn't the same, but it also very much is blended together and it crosses over, and it's kind of this, you know, crisscrossing stream of stuff that it's slowly all blending into the same thing, in my opinion. My inspirato, inspiration could be a tricky thing. And so that being said, I look at a lot of different places to get somebody. Okay. I look at a lot of different places for inspiration. I'll go a lot on the internet to get inspiration. If I'm at work and they say, okay, start thinking about this, I'll go onto the internet and start collecting reference off of Google, or, you know, digging into a specific thing. Kind of stop, ask what the project's about, ask what we're trying to say with the shot, and then go out and find reference for whatever it is that I need to do. Often, though, if I'm experiencing some block or whatever, I'll go out into the real world for inspiration for what I'm doing, because when you're matte painting or doing set extensions, all the inspiration you need is right out there. You just need to look out there and see how, get your nose in the tree and see how the tree looks, how it reacts to the wind, how it reacts to the sun, how mountains look in the background, yeah, all that. You know, you just go and get out there and look around and pay attention. The other day I stopped at the Triennial Museum and took a picture of a couple of the pieces of artwork there that I thought were great examples of the kind of things that inspired me. This was Clarkson Stanfield, Mount St. Michael, done in 1830, oil on canvas. The artwork that these old traditional painters did is still very much, it's the roots of what we do in these, creating these images is all very much this. These kind of paintings, this romantic, like, beautiful lighting. Everything is high, the castle is highlighted, but it's at the same time it's dark against the light background, and you have these layers and this beautiful composition. And these are the kind of things that when I'm starting a matte painting for myself, or, you know, or for work, I'll reference these kind of things to say, okay, you know, is this the mood first off that I want to have in there? Is this appropriate for this shot or these things? And these are great examples. This one is George Barrett, a view of Windermere Lake, 1781, oil on canvas. These are incredible. And there's a whole collection. I just wanted to add a couple of them, but there's a whole collection of these locally right here. You know, if you haven't been over there, head over. It was free, and it was an incredible exhibit, and there's a lot of really cool contemporary stuff there as well. There's a room where you go in and pick a flower and stick it onto the wall, and that was weird and cool. Also, a big, gigantic room full of skulls. Who doesn't love skulls right now? This is one of my photos, and I'm not putting this up here because I think I'm a great photographer. I'm putting this up here because the sky was incredible. And so my reference library is full of stuff like this because this inspires me. When I see a sky like that, I want to run home and go put it in a matte painting for absolutely no reason, to just stick on my drive and forget about. this kind of stuff happens in real life. This is the real world. These are the things that inspire me. I go out into the middle of nowhere, and when I get treated to a sunset like this, I'm just like, yeah, this is what it's all about. I'm completely, not only am I enjoying the moment, but it's sparking the inspiration in me to chase that kind of romantic imagery where it's just beautiful, these incredible sunsets and panoramic vistas and stuff. This next one is another image that I got that sticks out in my mind because this place, pardon me, is out in the desert. And the desert's usually just the desert, but this was 2 days after a rain. And I had my good friend Alex Nice was with me this day, and we went out there and we were going to photograph the desert. We had no idea that it was gonna be green like this, and it was just like this crazy, vibrant green for miles, you could see. And there's kind of the neat little road going up there, and I was like, man, this is life imitating art right now. We went out 2 days later to get more pictures, and all the green stuff was dead, and it was desert again. So this was kind of this weird, like, mirage type thing where it only lasted for just a brief time. And what's, you know, that's the inspiring thing about it is that it's a reminder that all these moments are just like passing so quick. And if you don't get out there and snatch it, like, you will miss it. And that's inspiration that you've missed out on, you know? So that's why I'm presenting these things. But enough of my boring photography. This is some John Berkey art. This is the guy that I mentioned that a lot of the Star Wars stuff was based on. Look him up. Go dig through the stuff. I'm not going to show a bunch of it here today, but his artwork is incredible. The scale of it, and this guy was doing this stuff in like the late 50s through the 70s, and he's just, his view is, you know, you read a lot about Mobius, Sid Mead. These guys are like the fathers of sci-fi imagery, and this guy doesn't get a lot of press, but his work is super inspiring to me. He's got this crazy, just like spaceship chases and like space bases and all this wild pulp sci-fi art that's really, really cool. And it does get referenced quite a bit in, well, Star Wars, obviously. Elysium, a lot of the stuff was based off of work that he did, but also this next one is an architect, actually, Santiago Calatrava. He's got a whole bunch of structures all over the world. He's got an incredible opera house in Barcelona. I think it's in Barcelona. And then in Milwaukee in the States, he's done the Art Museum. This one, I believe, is in the new World Trade Center. I think this was. But he did the old at LAX. The terminal at LAX looks like a big spaceship thing, and that was his architecture. And so architecture is another thing that, as a matte painter, you have to look for inspiration in architecture, because oftentimes you're required to make buildings. And so I literally know nothing about the history of architecture, but I do know about the looks of architecture. So I know kind of what I need to go for, but this is kind of neat because it's sci-fi. This next one is a little bit darker. Zadislaw Beksinski is this Polish guy who has some really disturbing, dark imagery. But these landscapes are really wild. A lot of people like H.R. Giger. I personally am more of a fan of Beksinski, his stuff. But that's just a personal preference. I think it's really crazy. Just deep, weird stuff. Really interesting. And the next one, this is probably one of my favorite artists because of the depth, the atmospheric depth, the lighting, how much contrast you see in here. This is Albert Bierstadt, and he spent a lot of time painting in Northern California, painting just scenery, landscapes, and this guy makes, you know, Bob Ross look like MS Paint. This is another Bierstadt painting, and once again, it's just that use of the atmospheric depth, the dramatic clouds, the dark light themes that we're always seeing in these paintings, and the scale. He's accomplishing such a great scale in these images, and it's really just, you know, it strikes an emotion. It creates a spark. When I look at this, I say, God, that's beautiful. I don't want to just look away and whatever's next. I want to sit and spend some time and really look at this. I want to go jump out into that landscape and go explore it. That's that inspiration happening. That's that spark. That's, you know, that's burned into my mind. When I go to start a painting, I'm going to go look at that and see, you know, see what he did there or what's going on. And those kind of things are when you're doing a job and creating work. I mean, you want to pour yourself into it, but you also want to put in proven things that you know are going to get the shot final, and you know it's going to make the director happy and help tell the story that you're trying to tell visually. So this guy personally, for environments, for digital matte painting stuff, if you make it look like this, they're going to final it 9 times out of 10. If you look at Dylan Cole's website or Robert Stromberg's website or any of the successful matte painters that are out there, all their stuff, they have tons of stuff that looks like this on their site. So I'm not the only person that loves Bierstadt. This is another Bierstadt painting. I just like the clouds, the way he's got this big tunnel, and you can see there's so much more going out might be Everest in the background that he dropped in there and something in the foreground. I don't know. He painted a lot from actual places, so this may or may not be an actual place. This one is from Yosemite. And then, that being said, this is a place called Hidden Lake. This is a little time-lapse video that I actually shot. I hiked up to this place and we camped out for a couple nights, a buddy of mine and I, and just set up the cameras and did time lapses. Well, we sat up there and watched the sun go down and watched these clouds come at us and just wrote down a bunch of ideas, took a bunch of photography, sat there, played our little guitars and stuff and just hung out. And it was so inspiring because it was like being in a Bierstadt painting when we were up there. And it's just a couple of minutes, this video, and so I'm sorry if it bores anybody to death, but it was, to be up that high and get that different perspective out there was great. When I was up there, I realized, like, holy smokes, we're actually, you know, our goal was just to get away from the weekend, and it turned into a complete realignment of my creative process when I went up there and hung out, because I was so far away from everything that is digital. And we were out, I mean, we hiked up to the top of this place, and as the sun was going down and I was looking and watching little airplanes just fly, you know, way down far away from us, I realized, like, holy smokes, man, it's really all about getting a different perspective on the things that you see and do every day. And, you know, I thought the time-lapse stuff was a great way to show that, which is why I included it in this, because it's important to go out, get out of your comfort zone, see different things, experience different things than you're used to, because that will lead you to be a more rounded in your art, in your creation, in your process. Constantly poke at the edges of it, see where it opens up and see where it leads you, and get out there and see it. That's where the inspiration is. Sometimes it's sitting right in front of you, and sometimes you gotta go chase it down on the top of the mountain and freeze your butt off overnight. So, yeah, I'll... And the clouds, watching the clouds come and go was breathtaking. But, make you suffer any more of that. Camera projections today. 3D camera projection is a 2D matte painting that's reprojected onto low poly or high poly geometry for that matter, from a 3D camera. This is kind of an image that's I grabbed off the internet. I thought it was a really great example showcasing what, you know, how this process works. From the camera's point of view, the shot will always line up unless you've done a terrible job on the painting. and from that point, if the camera starts to move, which I'll show you in a second here, all the images get projected through from that single point in 3D space, so it'll actually smear, it stretches out the image. So you end up with like multiple camera projections to patch the areas where it slides through, so then you can move a camera from A to B and still have matte paintings. So you kind of do like two or three or four or even more matte paintings for a single shot, and then you can fly the camera through and it often looks really good. You see a lot of that in Lord of the Rings. Half of that stuff is using that technique. So this is called matte painted 3D camera projection. This is a screenshot from some work I did for Bungie's Destiny. And this is looking through the camera down for a cutscene. And this is looking down through this tunnel right here. And this is just all OpenGL. It's not the final render. But you can see my setup there below. That's what a typical matte painting projection setup can look like. And so this is looking through the camera, and then when I move the camera off to the side, you can see there's that stretching that I'm talking about, where the camera is up to the top right of it, looking down, and that's where the image is getting projected onto the geometry. And so you can get a lot of detail from the image doing it that way, and then you can kind of open it up, and if you don't move the camera too much, simple push-ins and pull-outs are great for this technique if you only want to use one camera. If you start moving around too much, you have to do multiple cameras, and that can get tricky.
Quick question, Zach.
Yeah.
What software is typically used? Like, what do you use for 3D projections?
It's always changing, but I've gotten to the point where I try to do it in Nuke for as long as possible. And at a certain point, once Nuke gets bogged down, I'll go back into Maya and start going. But I almost always go from Photoshop, either back to Nuke or back to Maya to reproject.
Okay, right. So there's not like a specific tool that just does 3D projection. You use
No. I mean, I've written some scripts that help facilitate all of it, where you just like pick your camera, click a button, and it does the setup. It asks you to pick your image that you're projecting, then it'll set that up from the camera. You can add more cameras in, but there's no actual like matte painting toolkit application that exists.
Right. Yeah.
And so there's a lot of opportunities there if you're into coding to write something. Because nothing really exists. There's Cinema 4D has a really, really good projection package. A lot of artists love to use that one.
Okay.
And then 3D Max has some good matte painting tools. There's a guy named Marcus Booz that I worked with a number of years ago who wrote like a matte painting projection tool for 3D Max. And I'm not sure if I don't know if it works anymore. They're always changing the software. And so, yeah.
Gotcha.
You know, that depends. A lot of places will have, they'll have Enviro TDs, like junior matte painters that will do setup for the senior painters or whatever. Me personally, I love to do my own setups. I when they've tried to give me juniors, unless it's slow, I'm just like, I'm a control freak with it. I try to split stuff up when I'm in charge as much as I can, but when it comes to my own paintings, I almost 90% of the time want to set them up myself, just because there's so many little nuances that go on, and whenever I do a projection setup, it's usually like 30, 40 layers. You know, I do all sorts of little stuff like grass, flowers, atmospheric stuff, and everything. And so it can be really simple, and if it's really simple, I don't mind having somebody set it up. But if it's the typical thing, then there's just too, there's so much going on, I don't feel right making somebody else do it, because it's kind of boring, tedious work. And I like to do that, actually. But yeah, there's TDs. TDs will do a range of tasks. And it really depends on what studio you're at. If you're at a small studio, you're doing your own setups for sure. If you're at a bigger place, like Rhythm and Hughes had, when they were still a bigger company, had a lot of people there that were just setting up projections. And I've heard some of the other bigger companies, MPC, DNEG, those places will have like TDs that go through and set up stuff. But most artists are getting to the point where they're savvy enough to set up. You kind of run into that when you have somebody who doesn't know, who hasn't adapted to learn the process. If they're like just a really good painter, but they don't know how to use Nuke, they'll often get hired, and then we'll set up their stuff for them. That's kind of the only case where you really have that happening on a regular basis, is when they hire somebody who doesn't understand how to do it, has no desire to, which is fine as long as they're an awesome painter. So there's an unglamorous side to it. It's not all master shots and establishing shots. For the television show Fargo, this was the plate that I was handed, and they said, just make it snowy. So that's, you know, I was like, I don't want to be too presumptuous, but I'm going to get fit for a tux for this one here. And so it's kind of, you know, that's the nature of it. A lot of the work, more than you would think, is like this because of the whole nature of what matte painting is. It's such a cheap alternative to taking this set, renting the space, and then filling it all up with snow. You do something like this digitally, and it's done. This isn't a complicated shot. This was like a lock-off shot, which are still pretty rare, but you find them a lot in television shows. And this was a concept for a TV show. And I'm not sure if it ever happened yet or not. I don't think it did. But this is a concept where they said, this hose, we want to turn it into a snake. We want to have it turning into a snake. So just put some snake skin on it. And that was, you know, this kind of work comes in like big, it's like bananas. It comes in big yellow bunches, right? Like it's part of the beast, and you do it. And it's not exciting, but sometimes it actually is. It's kind of relaxing. You get it, and it's not like this big stressful thing. You're just like, yeah, it's easy to do it. This one is for a Danny McBride movie, Legacy of a White-tailed Deer Hunter, and it's just, you know, add the cliff in, make it look like he's standing up on a cliff. Cover up the sign, and there was a whole bunch of these that I had to do. And it's not, like I said, it's not like glorious establishing shots. It's not crazy work. It's not the kind of stuff that I'm like, you know, looking at beer stat paintings and being like, yes, I can't wait to just put a rock face on something. But it's, you know, it's bread and butter. It pays the bills and it's part of it. And it's a great opportunity to, because you have to remember all the time that when somebody's bringing this to you, they don't know how to do it. So even if you do it and you're like, this is boring, they're still gonna look at it and be like, really thankful. They're gonna be like, yeah, I couldn't do this. You know, if they did it, they could like sketch it out in MS Paint and hand you something that's just a hand turkey. But that's where you trace your hand in case you... Anyhow, yeah, so it's kind of that. And then this film, Black Skies, or Black Skies was the working title, Into the Storm. I don't know if any of you have seen it. This, for me, was the mother of boring work. So this is the breakdown video that I grabbed off of DD's site for this film. Literally all of it was replace a few clouds here and there and then paint the ground to look wet for all of these shots. And it was just like stuffed through the pipe. We did all this work in literally under a month. Like it came to us and they were just like, oh, we shot this stuff and we have no idea what to do with it. We're panicking, we're freaking out. You know, they bring it to you and it's on fire, half burnt in a bag. And they're like, oh, put the fire out and then make it not on fire. And you know, and then in this one, of course, there's a fire tornado at the end. So they're like, and then put it, make it on fire again, you know? So. And so these kind of shots here where, you know, it was remove all the stuff, paint over it, add the stuff back in the way we want it, clean it up, make it look, you know, make it do a thing. And so it was a lot of very rushed work, and it was, none of it was like glorious work. Like in something like this, I guess the point I'm making is something like this, the effects department are the heroes. They've got the hero work. And I'm in the back just like painting the fence like this, right? Cool, we're good. Go team. And so it's a lot of, you know, a lot of the work that you do as a matte painter ends up being kind of very supportive to another department. And that's what those are cool opportunities actually to learn a lot about what another department does and how your department can help serve theirs better. In this situation, there wasn't any learning involved. It was just literally, we called it the Enviro wet down. where we would go in and just camera project reflective areas where the road would be wet and then bring it into 3D and render sky reflection onto it. And then the compositing would just lay it over the top. Like we developed a really kind of a very simple system of dropping stuff in. And then of course there was the big fire tornado at the end, which this really brilliant guy named Brian Gazdick over at DD whipped up this fire tornado in a day and a half in Houdini. And that was literally all he had. And it just went in the film. And all of us, when it was done, were like, we got away with it. Yeah. Yeah, that was a wild ride. Still to date, about as crazy as it gets. But you can kind of see as it goes back and forth, you can see the subtle differences. And that was, they wanted it done. And none of it was glorious on my end. All the effects guys got all the, you know, did the, kind of the most work, but the least amount of work. They set it up really quick and just ran their setups and all went out and got drunk like every day. And for us, it was just like toiling, like, oh man, come on, I'm gonna paint, you know, five or six different projections for each shot. Like there was only three of us. And we were just scrambling to get it done. And the effects guys were all just drunk, having a great time. Like, ooh, we're just simming stuff, whatever. And I never wanted to be an effects guy so much in my life. I just got drunk at my desk instead. I did. No. concepting is a part that you may or may not get to take a part of. I like concepting because I think it's, you know, it's kind of a great chance to not be told what to do and kind of just get your free, they call it blue sky, you get a blue sky project where you just get, you know, they're like, well, we want a thing. And you're like, what kind of thing? They're like, we don't care a thing. Show us something. And that's great because, and it's also terrifying because you're like, oh God, I'm going to create something, I'm going to show it to them, and they're going to be like, we didn't want you to show us this. What were you thinking? Which happens. You just gotta play along. But concepting is great. It's a lot of fun, and I've done it in a lot of various like different stages. Just trying to get like a look for something basically, and they often come to you with like something that's half cooked, and they're just like, yeah, we just need you to cook it the rest of the way. And so it can be really odd, but it can also be really fun. And you don't always get to do it. Like in a bigger studio, you rarely get to do any concepting. All the concepting stuff that I do is from like outside of my job at DD. And it's like people with like personal projects coming to me wanting help, or like stuff for television shows. That kind of stuff is like the majority of my concept work. And so I'm gonna run through a little bit of that here now. Years ago, I had helped a friend pitch a video game. This is one of the stills that we used for this castle exterior, and I do not remember the name of the game he pitched. It never got picked up, and I asked him if I could use this, and he's like, "What? What are you even talking about?" And I reminded him, and he was like, "Oh God, I don't. Yeah, show it if you want to embarrass yourself." And so, so here I am, laid out before you. But yeah, this was kind of a fun thing, just like ZBrush it up, do a quick paint over. Like I didn't spend more than like an hour and a half creating this image, and it was just fast, loose, fun. And it was, you know, I spent like 3 days doing concepts at that level, just rushing through them as quick as I could just to get the kind of key art together for it. And a lot of it was very like moody, super contrasty, dark with a little bit of light coming into this landscape. And so concept is fun like that. And then this next one is for a Disney television show called The Descendants. I don't know, I actually don't end up watching a whole lot of television. But this was this kind of stuff, this saccharine, like super stylized, you know, Disney castle stuff makes me kind of want to vomit sometimes. But at the same time, it's fun work to do because you get to really just go against everything that you do in film. Like, unless it's a very stylized film, this kind of stuff, you just go wild. I go through my vacation photos and grab stuff, rah, and just photo bashing it together until I find something where I'm like, all right, and then throw it to the wall and see if it sticks. Because with concept, you don't have a lot of time, which is why the perspective is all crazy on some of this stuff. It's kind of if you really look at this and break it down from like, I would never show this to my supervisors on a film project. They would take one look at it and be like, you're out, next. But for the purpose of this thing, where they're like, yeah, we have 3 days for you to take this thing to final, and I actually had to composite this shot as well. Like I did the whole thing for the bumper on the show, this and a few other shots. And so it was just like, doing that stuff at home is a lot of fun. You take this concept, and then your concept turns into a final. And that's something that happens a lot, actually, when you do concept work. Feature film work is often concept is kind of like a word that they use to like do a final shot for us that you develop, and we're going to call it a concept, and then we're going to take it and put it in the film, and then they treat it like a concept and they run you through like it's like the same like timeline as a concept art, which is like, you know, they expect you to spend 5 hours on it and then have something final that they're going to put in the film. And it ends up taking a little bit longer, but it's kind of fun to do that also. Like it's one of those things where you're like, oh, I feel rushed. But then when it's done and it gets in there, sometimes it works out good. Sometimes you end up with four kids standing in the middle of a giant lens flare. This is some really quick and dirty concept art I did for a new show coming out called Krypton. It's the Superman's home planet legend stuff. I just did some concept art for it, and that's all I know. I started seeing advertisements for it recently because I did this art a few years ago, actually, with this producer guy, and hit me up, contacted me. He's like, "Hey, I want you to do some art for this Krypton show that we're pitching." And honestly, after about a year, we didn't hear anything back about it. I was like, "Must be dead in the water." And then he called me up a couple months ago. He's like, "Hey, great news! It's going through. We got it. We finally pushed it through." And I was like, had forgotten about it. I was like, "What? What's going through? What's going? Do I gotta buy a present for somebody? What's, you know, what's happening?" And so he's really excited about that. And this was, you know, it's kind of neat to see some of the stuff. Like he sat me down and showed me like what's going on with the show now, and a lot of the concept art that I had made it into the show. And it's to see it at a much more finished stage. They handed it to artists and had them actually create the stuff and create some of the sets for it. Was really cool. That's a great thing when you see your concepts come to life. That's cool. This is another little concept for the Krypton stuff. This is Superman's dad's crib in Krypton. But, you know, so once again, when I do this stuff, I tend to just kind of like set the timer, and when the timer's up, you're done. Unless I'm really like really in there and feeling it, then I'll drop a little bit more time on it. But with concept stuff, it's very much just get the idea across, which is why I use a lot of 3D kit bashing for my concepts, and then just do rough, quick paint overs. it's very much like my presentation yesterday, just smash and grab and go and boom, make it happen. This one was for Diary of a Wimpy Kid. Sometimes the concepts are a little more realized. Like I said, like if you're using photography for it, it can look a lot better. This is they prank the school and turn the trophy case into a fish tank. And so it was just, you know, go on to Shutterstock, grab a bunch of pictures of fish and sea critters and just drop them in there and make it work. And then this actually was one of those things that turned from the concept into the film. So some of the stuff from the concept got used in the actual shot from the compositors and put in there, whereas the fish were all moving, so they shot footage for that and replaced my stuff because it wasn't good enough. No, I'm kidding, because it wasn't moving. This one was for 12 Years a Slave. There's an actual shot, but they wanted me to concept up the old White House, what it would have looked like at the time, and that movie ended up going on to win a whole bunch of awards, which is kind of neat, because I don't feel like I had like anything specific to do with it, but it's kind of cool when something you work on goes and just sweeps all the awards, like La La Land went through and just linebackered its way through the Oscars, and I was just like, cool, man, there's a couple things in there. You know, if you get to get up and accept anything or get recognized, but in my own house, I was God that day. New tech. This is the exciting stuff, right? Sure, I just stared at this image for like 15 minutes before I put it in here. I was like, that is intense. That's how I feel every time I put those goggles on. That's enough, yeah. No more about my work. I'm going to switch gears, talk about the emerging technologies, VR, AR, touch a little bit on newer stuff that's even coming down the pipe further than that. But the first generation VR and AR stuff was clunky. We've seen it all the way back into movies in the 80s, there's a movie called Hackers. And in a lot of the scenes in the background, you can see people wearing these gigantic, like the same kind of stuff. It looks like they're wearing an Oculus Rift and sitting in this little thing, like just moving around all goofy. And it was like, in a lot of ways, the VR headsets haven't come a long way. And in a lot of other ways, it really has. It's making leaps. And it's all about, you know, the application of it and getting the funding. And so they're still trying to figure out kind of what to do with it. Some places we went to Zero Latency the other day, and that was really cool to see what they're doing with it. They've gotten the wires off of it. You're running around. You've got these fake guns and kind of running around this environment. And it was one of the cooler applications I've seen of it. We have a lot of VR setup stuff where I work at DD, and we got a gigantic sound stage, and they had Steven Spielberg in there to show him off, and I thought they were gonna like load up one of these crazy huge environments that we have that we're doing for previs and stuff in there. Nope, they put a podium and a Diet Coke, and gave him one of the little handles for the HTC Vive, and he just picked up the Coke and he was like, huh, that's kind of neat. It's like, really? You guys like wooed him with a diet, or a Diet Pepsi is what it was. And they're like, yeah, he loves it. He's always got to have it. I was like, all right, man. You guys are calling the shots. But the cons of the original stuff were, heavy technical limitations. The tech it requires a lot to figure out how it all is. Graphics are like they were, you know, it's, you're back to the Stone Age, the technical Stone Age, with the graphics quality of stuff. It was really expensive. The pros were you have a new way to tell a story or a new experience that they can market and sell. You now have the ability to walk around and interact with your designs. That's really cool. Just having the headset where it's a passive experience is one thing, but being able to get up and cruise around and be tracked in that 3D space is a total game changer. It's a new frontier with new rules that we get to break and figure out, kind of bounce off the walls and see where everything starts opening up. So it's really cool. Whole different world now. VR is an art tool. I just quickly wanted to touch on this because there's a lot of people using Tilt Brush, using these other sketching applications, and this guy is a Disney artist who's like drawing Beauty and the Beast stuff in there and just making his artwork is online. It's crazy. You go Google like Tilt Brush, Beauty and the Beast or whatever, and this guy is drawing incredible things in this 3D space. The first time I used something like Tilt Brush, I was in there and I kind of sketched and messed around a little bit, and I immediately was like, this isn't like a great production tool, but you know, if you're in there to just create art, this is amazing to be in. You know, you think about being in a space like this and being able to just grab a brush and walk and it's animated stuff, sparks flying off of it, and you have all these new tools that are, you know, it's a new way to create artwork and in a space where you could share that with other people and let them experience, you could create an experience for other people, something to that they can load up and walk through what you've done and kind of trace your steps and see what you've done. It's really cool. Quill is another one. I mentioned Tilt Brush, Medium. There's people doing a lot of 3D sculpting stuff in this. That's in VR. That's really cool. Those communities are out there. There's some of it on ArtStation. A lot of it is like in Facebook groups and whatever Instagram groups that you can go and kind of search it out and find it. There's a lot of really, really neat stuff out there with that. Currently, I'm at Digital Domain and working on a Marvel project, and I can't really, like, we're using VR for a lot of those processes for our pre-viz when we're dealing with clients, so I can't, like, bring any of that stuff and show it, unfortunately. But I did want to share this thing, which I kind of helped from a distance on this, and this is one of those passive VR experiences I was talking about. It's called Micro Giants, and this is just the trailer for it. The actual thing is like 15 minutes long. And you're going through these environments, and we're rendering these out, like we're setting these environments up, and we're rendering these out as 3D panoramas, and you're wearing the headset, and when you're in there, and this stuff is flying by you, and it's all huge like that, it's actually kind of neat, and they're incorporating, you know, other things with it, like mist generators and fans and all this other stuff. The sound is all there, and it's a really, really immersive experience, and that kind of stuff is really neat, I feel like the storytelling aspect with that medium is kind of struggling to push it forward, because how do you, you know, if it's not something, it's something like that really lends itself to it, but like an action film could also be cool, but there's certainly, if it's a scene where you have two people talking, if it's just like a talking head scene, like it's, I don't know, I feel like it would be weird personally to sit there and just kind of be able to stare at the floor while you're in an intense scene in the film. It kind of takes that, it allows for the film to kind of lack what film and storytelling currently has. So it's an interesting problem that has yet to be solved, and I'm curious to see where people take it. It's pretty exciting. Let's see here, Star Wars Rogue One, they used off-the-shelf VR tools for production. Oh, go ahead.
Are you able to say how you're rendering out into panoramas?
Yeah, I don't understand all of the nuts and bolts of it, but it's not as simple as loading up a single camera and just rendering a sphere, because it's two eyes, and there's a certain point where the eyes kind of cross, so you have to render two panoramas, right? One for each eye, and the interocular distance, there's a point where the lines converge and it gets goofy, and so then it has to be rendered and split into all these little slices that are then reassembled. The process that somebody else who was way smarter figured out, they tried to explain it to me and I was just like a dog that got tied to the bumper of a car and forgotten. Like I kept up for about 10 feet and I was just like, they just drug me the rest of the way through it. smarter people than me are sorting that out for sure. But it's kind of neat when you see it, when because just to illustrate it for me, they're like, here's what it does when we don't do it that way, and I was just like, oh, get the headset off me, I'm gonna throw up. But then when they do it right, it's believable. You have to adjust the interocular distance and all that. There's a lot of different tweaking that goes on in that. But yeah, what happens is the cameras end up kind of looking like through each other during these renders. And it's the best way I can think of to describe it. There's white papers out there, which I've tried. Like, I went through like a week where I was like, no, I'm gonna understand this, I'm gonna get it. And then after the end of that week, I was like, I got better shit to do.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome. So yeah, they're using off-the-shelf VR tools for film production to get all these scenes all set up. And this is something you're seeing a lot more, where somebody's going into the director or the director of photography is going into these VR environments and they have their little loop tool in there that they're looking through their viewfinder and they're saying, boom, giving snapshots for the artist to make key art for and everything and say, this is, you know, I'm pre-vising my shot in here, flying it around and doing all this stuff. And it's a really cool new tool for doing all this kind of stuff. You know, you can get a lot of the way in a very short amount of time with all this. The future of VR, AR, Microsoft had their HoloLens, and they released it, and it kind of hasn't done much. And you have, what was the name of the company? Magic Leap. I've had a bunch of friends go and get jobs at Magic Leap, and they've just disappeared, so who knows what they're doing. Maybe Magic Leap is eating people. but from what I've heard, there's a lot of really, really cool technology coming out of that place that they're hopefully using these light field technology, whatever that means. It sounds futuristic, right? And hopefully they're heading towards an actual holographic projection scenario where you maybe only have to wear a set of glasses or goggles that aren't the big, gigantic, forever alone stuff. But medical field, architecture, all sorts of things are to be able to visualize it. You have AR applications on your phone where you look through the camera and stuff is composited in real time. That's a great tool. I wish that we had more tools like that for visual effects where you could look at your screen and say, okay, let's swipe through some stuff just to at least get like some concepts out or get work and help flesh out your process quicker rather than having to go and hunt for stuff online. Like there's so many ideas. You could sit there and brainstorm all day, but you just got to clean up after the brainstorm. But the future of it, yeah, architecture and medical engineering and medical field is really advancing quite a bit from all this stuff. It's really neat. And previous situations are probably benefiting the most, and they're using it all over the place. Everywhere that I go, everybody that I talk to, they're using the VR for previs predominantly. Coming down the pipe, neural net processing. This stuff is crazy. I don't know how many of you are on Reddit. There's a video, there's deep fakes, and then there's like this Nicolas Cage video where they took Nicolas Cage's face and put him in Superman. and then they put him in Titanic, and they put his face in all these things. But one of them, I actually didn't grab it and put it in here, and I should have, was they had somebody took this algorithm and replaced Carrie Fisher's face in the new Star Wars, and they did it for the cost of what they figured out. It was like $500, and it was kind of more believable than what ILM had done. And so that's a wake-up call right there. Like, it's time to start embracing this technology and utilizing it rather than spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on teams of artists to get something that doesn't get as good of a result, So this neural net processing is really, really cool stuff. I've been playing with it a bunch for the last couple months. There's the code is out there on GitHub, online, all over the place. You have your original photos here on the left, and then you feed it the reference photo, and then you get the result. It automatically does it. It's a machine learning algorithm. It's playing around with AI. So I'm trying to have fun with it before the system becomes self-aware and attacks us all. So we're very like headed towards the kind of Skynet territory here. This thing, HRISM, or high resolution image synthesis and semantic manipulation. This is based on some tech papers that somebody over at NVIDIA had teamed up with MIT and created this system using basing it off of NVIDIA's been working a lot on self-driving cars and that technology and machine learning and using all that stuff. And then I was kind of interested in that because we're entering now a world of automation. And so I'm kind of just like, I don't know, I love to tinker and I'm interested in all that sort of stuff. And so I stumbled across this and I was like, you've got to be kidding me. This is out there. They're drawing maps over the images and then feeding the program other images, and it's going through and swapping out each one of these colored areas with something else. The note I have here is this technology is also in its absolute infancy, but where it's headed is certainly interesting, relevant. Similar to a few apps you might be running on your phone, a process called style transfer, which is what we saw in the previous slide, where AI transfers looks of images fed into a designated image. And it's actually really close to a lot of the stuff that Adobe has in Photoshop now with all their content-aware features that work every once in a while. So these are some other images of what it's doing, the high-resolution image synthesis, semantic manipulation. This is literally where if AI is going to go crazy on us, it's going to happen with this stuff. There's a bit of code that I came across. This is the one that I've been playing with. It's called PyTorch. And it requires some specific hardware, but if you check it out, you can download the code off GitHub and you can play with your own images. And this is going to be a great tool for getting a bunch of concept wedges out for when somebody says, we like this image, but we want to see some different versions of it. You could load up that image and load a bunch of other images in and say, go to town, computer, and it'll give you like 20 of them. The crazy thing is that it'll give you 19 good images, and then the last one will be like pictures of steaks and animals and stuff. Like, the computer really just wants to turn and be like, kill. Like, it's pretty crazy. It's wild stuff. Really exciting, really cool. Like I said, in its infancy, and it's a great opportunity and time to get, like, you know, if you feel the draw to the tech side of it at all, definitely check this out, because it's exciting and cool stuff, and it's definitely going this way. We're experimenting back at work with using this kind of technology to automatically roto stuff. So that's a relief. I don't know anybody that enjoys doing it. So some resources.
Sorry, I've got a quick question.
Yeah.
Do you think that the type of technology you were showing just before is going to eventually put you out of a job?
Probably.
How do you feel about that?
It's not going to happen tomorrow. Yeah. It's down the road. The same way that, you know, the way I look at it is, you know, when matte painting turned from glass matte painting to digital matte painting, a bunch of the glass matte painters said, well, that's it. I'm going to go move to Florida and you know, start up a landscaping company for my retirement or whatever. They were just like, that's done, that's it, this is replacing me. And a lot of the other people who were in it adapted, and they said, okay, well, I'm going to find out how, you know, what this new technology is and how to embrace it. And so that's the way I look at it. I mean, it's not going to put me out of a job, because I'm going to see it coming and get out of that job well before it puts me out of a job. That's kind of, you know, it's the whole problem solving thing. I don't see it as a problem. I see that stuff as an opportunity. And for me, this stuff is a great opportunity to get. I know it doesn't make sense, but that to me is a resource that gets the technology out of the way. You know, that technology has an interface to it, and you can pop a bunch of images in and say, yeah, that one. You grab that image, clean it up, do a bunch of stuff to it, and then you're done. Then you get to go home for the day or stay there for another 10 hours. but it's kind of, that's exciting to me, because as much as I enjoy it, sometimes I don't want to do 20 versions, you know, and have the computer do 20 versions for me, or at least most of the way. Like, that's great. That's perfect for me. I could spend more time doing something that I care about then, you know. So, yeah, I kind of just look at it that way. I see it as an opportunity rather than a loss or something like that. It's, you know, drink my own Kool-Aid, so to speak.
Thanks.
So some art books that I recommend checking out if you're into this. Alla Prima, Everything I Know About Painting. It's a great book. Invisible Art of Matte Painting. There's tons of resources in that. The Art and Science of Digital Compositing is a great book. There's a lot to be learned about the process through that. The Art of John Berkey. I have two copies in case one gets in a fire. Fantastic Art of Beksinski. It's the crazy Polish guy I was talking about. The works of Liu Huihan, I probably murdered his name, but I love his artwork. It's great. My favorite artists, currently some of the people that I look to for inspiration when I'm just like stuck in a rut. David Levy is great. Sparth, Nicolas Bouvier, he's a game artist. Probably a lot of you know who he is from the Halo stuff. Xiaoming Wu, Stefan Martinier, Albert Bierstadt, and Wayne Barlow. Wayne Barlow is one of the, if you don't know who he is, he does amazing like landscapes. He's got this really dark series of stuff, but he also designed a lot of the creatures in Avatar, all the banshees and all that kind of stuff. And he's got some really cool, very odd, kind of Mobius almost inspired type sci-fi creatures. Really, really neat stuff. Really quick talk just about like working with clients. They're always the boss, it's great, and do whatever it takes to make them happy, because a happy client will come back all the time, and it's tough because you don't ever want to say no to them about anything. And because when you, sometimes you do have to say no, you have to say, I'm gonna be out of town right then, and then they won't call you back for like a couple years. They're like, okay, we'll find somebody else. And that's fine, you know, they always, it's like cyclical. As long as you do a good job, always bring you back, all the time. Yeah, study everything you can. Don't just focus on one thing. A lot of people will talk about being a specialist versus being a generalist, and I say go ahead, specialize, but don't close yourself off so that you're only focusing on one thing all the time. And that's really, you know, that's kind of the long and short of it. Really quick, before I wrap it up here, just gonna run out of time, is resources, software, Maya, Houdini, Nuke, Reality Capture, Photoshop, ZBrush, World Environment Tools, Unreal and Unity, web-based stuff. There's a lot of stuff coming out on the web. Get onto GitHub, check out all the crazy projects people have on GitHub. It's crazy. I mean, I know the tech stuff is really daunting and the coding side of it can be really intimidating. So, you know, start simple if you want to get into that. And I would say if you don't, you know, if you haven't done either, just focus on the art. And the tech stuff will come down the line, and it doesn't have to. I personally like it because it allows me to take my art to a place that there might not be tools for. So I decide, you know, I develop a workflow, and there's no tools that exist to do it. I find myself doing the same thing in succession over and over and over again. I'm just like, that's a good place to put a for loop and just automate it. So it gets the tech out of the way. Education, schools like Noman are great. I wish that I personally would have gone to Noman because my school had no like professionals in it. They had people that had worked doing commercials like 3 years before. We had software that none of the teachers knew how to use, and they, you know, we kind of were like stuck learning it on our own. So somewhere like Noman is great because you have industry professionals teaching classes, people who are currently working on films and in it, and they're in it for now. They know the techniques, they know other people, and it's an amazing resource. I really wish that I would have just moved out and gone there instead of what I did. Not that it didn't work out for me, but it was could have been a lot easier, I think. continue afterwards, once you are done with your education, you never stop learning. That's just the nature of this industry, a rolling stone, no moss, et cetera, and that's the same thing with this. It's fast moving, it's constantly changing. You've got stuff constantly coming up that looks like it's just coming straight for your job, and so you kind of gotta keep running, keep ahead of the ball, and be excited about it. That's why I stress, be inspired, be excited about it. Find something you're excited about, cling to it until it disappears, and then go find another thing and do the same thing. It's just, you gotta have to stay pumped about what you're doing, because it's a lot of work. It's kind of ends up being a lifestyle, and it's exciting. It's great. It's really rewarding, and it's amazing. You just gotta stick with it. Staying up to date with newest software is kind of covered. We were just talking about collecting image libraries off the web for inspiration. Keep an inspiration folder. Have like carry like a little book with you, or a, you know, Google Docs on your phone, or whatever you have to do to keep yourself interested in this. And also it serves as a great kind of like a diary, like an inspiration diary, where you can go back and see where you were 5 years ago or 6 years ago or whatever, and say, wow, man, I've grown a lot as an artist, or I have more growth to do, or, you know, just to give yourself that perspective, to get you up on that mountaintop watching the clouds flying by in your mind. And so that kind of stuff, you know, going to these websites and keeping up and being inspired and challenged by the work that's on there is important. You know, as artists, we have to constantly sharpen ourselves on each other, you know, the way you sharpen a knife. Same kind of stuff. Photography is cross-pollinated with what we do inherently. And so at least learn how a camera works at the basic level. And go out, take pictures, learn how to frame stuff, learn how to light stuff, learn the technical side of it, or learn the artistic side of using the camera. But get out, take pictures, understand the image capturing process, because at the end of the day, with matte painting and environment work, that's what you're doing. You're making images. You're using a camera. You're just doing it on a computer instead of being out in the real world. But being out in the real world and walking around with the camera and snapping shots is a great way to really improve your skill on the computer. That will translate over. Whether you're focusing on it or not, the more you shoot actual pictures, the more you will actually create pictures when you're on the computer. And so, yeah, that kind of wraps it up. That concludes it.